sure, when I say 100, I say I include people producing 2,000, 3,000 bottles. But they are anyway, they are producers of an ECHNA DOC. So that's what I have to include. So it's a little bit proud, but what I like to say is that if people they do good things, if the people they go with quality, they do good quality, they are welcome on Mount Etna. Many people, they come from other areas of Italy producing wine on Mount Etna, from Tuscany, from Piedmont. We have Gaia on Mount Etna. We have many other important names. We have foreign people coming on Mount Etna. So everyone is welcome. But as an Etna guy, as an Etna family, I always say, come to Mount Etna, but please don't do stupid things in terms of quality, in terms of image of our production area. And so that's my feeling, my actual feeling. So this is the area, and we are located on the northern side of Mount Etna. As you see, it's marked over there. We face the northern part of the island, and we face the peninsula. We face Italy. And we are in a small village called Solicata. Who was there knows that it's a very small vineyard. So we are where we are located. And Pietra Dolce is a family winery, was born in 2005, but I love to say that we did not start producing wine. We restarted because my grandfather was a wine producer 100 years ago on Mount Etna, but he was on the south part of Mount Etna. So he owned about 1 hectare of vineyards. He was producing wine for the family and for sale to the friends. So that's why I love to say we restarted producing wine. The wine is in our blood since 100 years, thanks to my grandfather Michele, with my the same name I have. So 2005, Pietra Dolce is born. We bought a small plot of land in Solicata, and then we get bigger, a bit bigger, but not huge, because we remain a family winery. We like to be a boutique winery, and we don't want to change this mentality. We don't want to change this let's say state of mind.
Yeah, and Michele, how many total hectares of vineyards does Pietra Dolce own at the moment?
Only 30 hectares, but we cultivate about 26, 27. We have to do new plantation for 3-4 hectares in the coming future.
Okay, in the DOC or in San Cru, in San Contrada?
All our 90% of our vineyards are located in the northern side, inside the DOC. A small part, only a couple of hectares, is located the eastern side of Mount Etna, in Milo, M-I-L-O. It's a small village in the eastern side. Is where we produce Archineri, Etna Bianco, and Sant'Andrea.
Okay. And how many kilometers from Solicchiata?
About 40 minutes driving, which is about 30 kilometers, 25 kilometers.
Okay.
So this is the only plot that we have out of the Solicchiata area. So all the rest is in Solicchiata and Passo Pisciaro area. We are really strongly connected to this area. We like this area. You see, Benedetta, on the right part of the screen, there is a green area.
Yeah.
This is an old volcano. This is a Monte Dolce. It's a very old volcano just aside to the winery, and it's very nice. It's amazing because now it's covered by green, by trees, but in the past it was a volcano. So, as I was saying, we are strongly connected to this area. We like to stay in this area, which is the most reputed for Etna DOC, for red Etna DOC.
It's so, the most located, okay. So here in the yellow part that I drawn, Michele, is all the, let's call it, young vines that you have, that you use for your Etna Bianco, Etna Rosso, and Etna Rosé. and those are all in this area, just around the winery, because the winery is here, guys. This one is the winery.
That's the new winery. We will show you in a few minutes. Pictures. The yellow, the plot that you marked in yellow is our, is one of the youngest we have, is where we produce, yes, Etna Rosso, some Etna Bianco, not all of it, and some Etna Rosato. It's about 10 years old. Inside this plot, we have the winery. And this is, let's say, the young area of our production. And then if we wanna, I like to say, if we wanna go back to the past, we have to go to the blue and to the red area that you mark, just behind the winery. These are two of our prephylloxera vineyards. When I say prephylloxera, I mean about 900 years old. And it, in blue, it's a Contrada Rampante vineyard. And in red is Archinieri Etna Rosso vineyards. So, of our prephylloxera vineyards.
And to complete the Cru range, now we go here in Passo Pisciaro, right?
Exactly, that's a Contrada Santo Spirito wine. Contrada Santo Spirito Etna Rosso. In Contrada Santo Spirito, which is a macro area, which is a big area, we own these 4 hectares, and we have a nice story regarding these 4 hectares. When we bought this land, it was completely covered by weeds, by wild weeds. No vines in this plot. All in a sudden, when we started cleaning the plot, we discovered that under the wild weeds, there were some vines, prephylloxera, 120 years old. So we say, wow, what is this? And there were two vines there, all around the land. So we say, what we do? We have to transplant these plants, and we have to maintain them. We decide to maintain. So in the 4 hectares, we can collect more or less 1.5 hectares of prephylloxera vines. And we started producing Santo Spirito in 2016. That's why Santo Spirito was born. Very nice in this picture are out of the red area are the lava flows. You see the black, all the black and gray are, not so deep. If you go down the screen, you see gray area, gray and black area. This is all lava coming out of the volcano. It's like a river, a black river. You see, these are all the lava flows that came out from the volcano years and years ago. You see, the black, I call it, this is all the lava that came out from the volcano during the centuries. That's it. And I want to go back to Contrada Rampante behind our winery, Benedetta, to explain you which is our philosophy, to explain you which is our strategy. In the same area, which is a Contrada Rampante, it's a big Contrada. When I say Contrada, I mean Cru, a big Cru. In the same big Cru, we produce Contrada Rampante Etna Rosso, we produce Archinieri Etna Rosso, we produce Barbagalli Etna Rosso.
Barbagalli, guys, is this one, this small one here.
And especially in the case of Archinieri Etna Rosso and Contrada Rampante Etna Rosso, you could tell me, why don't you put all together? They are so close one to each other, no? So you can produce a unique wine, a single wine, from a unique area, because the two vineyards are very close one to the other. But I say no, and you know why? Because when we started producing, when we started doing some micro vinification from the two vineyards, we discovered that the composition of the soil, the minerality of the soil, and the type of the soil are completely different from each other, because the two vineyards, they stand on two different lava flows. It means that the different lava flows generate different minerality, different soil composition. That means different ones. So that's why in the last years we are trying to go deeper in the system of the crew, and inside the big crew we wanna really identify the small flow, if you wanna use a French word. So we wanna identify small flow inside the big crew, which is the French system, what the French people they do since many and many years. They have inside the big clue, a big crew, they have a small flow. In our big crew, which is the Contrada Rampante, we have three claw. One is Barbagalli, it's Arcineri, and one is the blue one that we call with the same name of the area, Rampante. So I like to remark, I like to say this, because it's something I'm convinced that only a small boutique winery can do. This logic, this way of thinking, it's not easy to do if you are a winery producing millions and millions of bottles. If you are a small winery, boutique winery, you have passion for this terroir, you want to go deeper in this terroir, and you do what we're trying to do.
So, yes, Michele, so this is, I thank you for the research and for differentiating, and actually, this is micro-vinification, micro-care of every single plot. But if you have to identify the three crews and identify with their own characteristic each of the three, how would you describe the main difference between the three?
I would say Rampante more. If they would be brothers, Rampante is the more energetic body brother.
Full bodied.
Arcineri is more on the, let's say, elegance. Barbagalli is more in the perfection. How can you say? Mm-hmm. It's a great balance of everything.
Yeah, we tasted a couple of years ago in one of the last sales meeting, all the Canadian teams tasted the three crews, so Santo Spirito, Arcineri and Rampante. Can you confirm that maybe Arcineri is a little bit smoky, has a smoky taste, while Rampante is more fruity, ripe fruit?
I can confirm the smoky taste is thanks to the smoky feeling of the soil, because it was probably more strong tasty lava flows, you understand. And sorry, I forgot to tell you, Santo Spirito, which is in Passo Pisciaro, a couple of kilometers far away, is the more Burgundy style of the soil. It's a very flat, is on the top of an hill, very flat. And the windy, bit more windy, so more on the freshness, you know. That's it.
And in terms of production, Michele, number of bottles produced from each of the crew. I'm talking about Santo Spirito, Rampante, and Arcineri. Do they have more or less the same production?
No, not at all. We produce about 7,000-8,000 bottles of Arcineri et Tenarosso. We produce about 4,000-5,000 of Rampante, 2,500 bottles of Barbagalli that, as you know, we sell by allocation, and about 4,000 bottles of Santo Spirito. I like to call them a micro vinification. And once again, if you are a small boutique winery, you can really do this kind of quantity. If you are a big winery, it's not logical.
Sure. And Michele, you use only indigenous grape. When it comes to the red, we have Nerello Mascalese and Nerello Cappuccio. And when it comes to the white, we have Carricante. Between Nerello Mascalese and Nerello Cappuccio is mostly Nerello Mascalese, right?
Yeah, we do not use Nerello Cappuccio. We do not plant and do new plantation on Cappuccio. Cappuccio was used in the past to give color, to give body to Nerello Mascalese, because as you know, Gnello Mascalese is very light color, very more on the elegance, on the light color.
But like a Pinot Noir, sort of Pinot Noir style.
We don't need the body, we don't need color. That's why we do not use the cappuccio, and very few people they use a cappuccio. We only have a few plants of cappuccio in the old Prefiloxera vineyards, because our grandfather, they used to plant a few cappuccio in the vineyard. That's why we find very few plants of cappuccio in the Prefiloxera vineyards. In the new plantation, no cappuccio at all.
Okay. Guys, as you know, since we are not a lot, we are around 15 people here. If you want to ask Michele a question while we are here in the seminar, go ahead without waiting for the final part. So don't be shy. So if you have some questions about this part in terms of vineyards, soil, and the area, don't be shy and ask Michele. Michele is always very available.
See. Before they start their question, let me finish it, saying that we are really extreme in terms of protecting the terroir, in terms of protecting the tradition. That's why we only produce Nerello Mascalese for red, Carricante for white. That's why our choice is to produce our cru. And when I mean cru, I mean the label, so with the nice lady on the label, no? The bottle with the nice lady that we call the volcano lady, no?
Yeah.
You see smoke and you see lava on the dress. And all the labels with the lady are pre-phylloxera. And that's why we decided, we are really traditional, we are really extreme. My decision from the beginning was to produce all our cru using Prefiloxera vines. And the entry level, the wines with that vibration on the label, you know, I call it the volcanic vibration. That's a strange
pattern.
That's a strange design are the entry level. So we produce three entry level, Etna Rosso, Etna Rosato, Etna Bianco, with the volcanic vibration on the label. And then we produce all Prefiloxera cru with the lady on the label. And we are really extreme. We want to really protect the idea. We want to really protect the tradition. That's why we want to keep continuing going on this way. I finished.
Yeah, sorry, Michele. I forgot to map, or maybe, I mean, we didn't talk about it. The Sant'Andrea. The white for producing Sant'Andrea, where does it come from? Where does the grape come from here?
I told you we have just one plot on the eastern side of Mount.
In Milo.
In Milo, which is the eastern part of the Iron, you know. And it's a small village at about 850 meters. We own these Prefiloxera vineyards 130 years old. And only Carricante Prefiloxera.
Let me identify Milo on the map now that we are here together. Wow!
There you are, yeah. You see, you are on the eastern part of, yeah? Facing...
Sorry guys for this roller coaster, but I wanted to let you see where is Milo. Okay.
At 850 meters above sea level, we own a single vineyard. This is the only one that we have out of the northern part, out of Solicata. And from this vineyard, we produce Archinelli, Etna Bianco, and Sant'Andrea.
Okay.
One from a single vineyard. And what we do, we produce, at the beginning, we started producing only Archinelli, Etna Bianco years ago from this vineyard.
Mm-hmm.
In 2005, in 2015, we said, okay, let's give more value to our Carricante. Let's develop a great idea. I hope it's a great idea. And we decided to select the best plants, the best terraces, and we do a separated vinification of the best vines, and in a single 2,000 liter hog tank, and we do 10 months skin contact, 10 months maceration. And that's how Sant'Andrea is born. It's born with the idea to give more value to a Prefiloxera Carricante. So, okay. The same vineyards, we keep continuing producing Archinelli Etna Bianco, Prephyllocera, but with the normal vinification in stainless steel tanks. And we produce this single barrel of 2,000 liters of Sant'Andrea, choosing the best plants with 10 months skin contact, and then 1 year in bottle.
Michele, sorry, speaking about ovinification, the Santo Spirito, Rampante and Archineri crew, so all the difference comes only from the soil. I mean, the vinification is exactly the same for all three.
Exactly. Let me say that we give much less importance to what we do in the cellar, in the winery, than what we do, what the vineyards give us. It means that the difference is just the place where we produce the grape, because the vinification is the same for Santo Spirito, Rampante, and Archineri Rosso. It means that we harvest by the end of October, and then we do about 15 soft pressure, and then 15, 17 days skin contact. And then we age the three wines for 14 months in 700 liter barrels that we use and reuse many times. I don't like to put too much new hop in my wine. I just give to my wine 10, maximum 15% of new hop. So yeah, we use our barrels many times. So,
I'm sorry, Michele, but the fermentation of the three happens in cement, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's a good question. We started in 2016 testing some cement tanks, tulip tanks, and finally we decided to put everything during the fermentation in cement tank. It's just a kind of back to the past, because you know our grandfather were doing vinification in big cement tanks. Naturally, these are modern tanks, these are tulip-shaped tanks, but it's a kind of an old way of vinification. And it's a cement inside and cement outside. It means a micro-oxygenation, very important.
Natural micro-oxygenation, okay.
Made for Barbagalli in cement, with the big difference that Barbagalli is aged 20 months in 700 liter barrels.
Okay, 20, yeah, right. And Michele, going back to the agricultural technique, is everything organic in Pietra Dolce?
Totally organic.
Certified organic?
Yeah, we are certified in the vineyards. We are certified.
Okay.
Yes,
okay.
And we use no pesticide, no herbicide. It costs a lot of time and money, but that's our choice. We want to keep continuing this way.
Yeah, and also the volcanic soil definitely is easier to manage in an organic way. I mean, there is less spreading of illness, those kind of sickness typical of the vineyards.
I think that on Mount Etna we are very lucky, because we have a mix of different situation. It means that we have freshness, we have fresh weather, we have a bit of wind, we have sun, so we really do not have a lot of problem of sickness. We do not spray, we only spray organically, but we don't have, honestly, such big problem of disease like they have in Northern Italy, I guess.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, so I would stop sharing the map.
You want to show some pictures, perhaps?
Yes, sure. I see here some questions by the guy, by the shy Canadian guys.
Shy.
No, yeah, they are not shy at all, but they don't want to ask questions. I don't know why. So I'm reading you, Michele, what they wrote and what they want to ask you. The first question is from Joel from Ontario, Toronto. Oh, this guy with the nice girl close to him. For younger vines that are grafted, is there a type of rootstock that succeeds best on volcanic soil? Quindi c'è un piede, c'è un tipo di radice che va meglio nella volcanic soil?
Yes, we have roots. We selected a couple of good rootstock for the volcanic soil. Yes, for sure. For the young vines, for sure, because as you know, the old ones are prephylloxera. But we have a couple of typical couple of Mount Etna that we usually use.
Is it okay, Joel? You can unmute yourself.
I'm trying to find that. Is there a particular type? Is it of a vitis designation or like a number? Or
it's the one which is called the 104 Ruggeri. So there is a particular type that we use, especially on volcanic soil on Mount Etna, which is completely different from the rest of Sicily. I like to call Etna, Mount Etna, an island in the highland, because you can never compare Mount Etna to other area of Sicily or on the coastline, because it's a different climate, a different soil, a different wine. So I like to compare more Sicily to Alto Adige than the rest of the highland, Mount Etna, to compare Mount Etna to Alto Adige, to the rest of the island in terms of finesse, elegance, and minerality. So that's why we have special condition, and so we need a special rootstock.
And then we have a question from Mr. Rostron, and actually it was something that I also wanted to ask. Is it possible to write organic grown on the label?
Normally you write organic when you are organic in the cellar and in the vineyards. We are organic actually in the vineyards, and it could be in the future also in the cellar, but we will see. But I think that by the law in Italy, you can write organic when you are both organic in the cellar and the vineyard.
You can put the symbol if everything is organic, but you can anyway write from organically grown grape, I think. But there is no symbol of the green leaf. You cannot use the green leaf.
The different, Benny, the difference is that we use sulfite, we use some quantity of sulfite, which is normal to protect the wines. I don't know if in the organic way they can use or cannot use, but we don't use anything else. So I like to say practically we are organic, officially we cannot write organic. That's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you can say it anyway.
Yeah.
And I didn't do the elevation game. So what's the difference in the elevation of the entry level wine, Michele, and the Barbagalli?
Entry level, it's about 800. We go up to 850 for Artineri and Rampante. Barbagalli is 900 and 120, and it's at the limit of the DOC, because in that special area the DOC finish at 1000 meters. There is a road passing there at 1,000 meters, and the DOC finished there, and we are at 920, so at the limit of the DOC in a real extreme condition, really extreme condition in terms of harvest, because we harvest by hand. It's all rocks, small terraces. You saw Barbagalli, so it's all about hand harvesting. It's difficult. It costs a lot of money. It costs a lot of, you need passion to work that kind of land, you know.
Grazie, Michele. And a question again from Vancouver, from Brandon. The trellis method for the vines, are they all the same or different for crew vineyards? So it's basically alberello, but is that alberello for everything or just for the crew?
No, that's our personal choice. We have alberello for the prephylloxera for sure, because we found them as alberello shape. But when we do new plantation, we do new plantation at alberello shape. We are, when I say we are really extreme, in our way of thinking or way of working, I mean this. We could easily do new plantation by using spalliera, you know, by using this kind. but we don't like it. We think that Mount Etna, the protecting tradition of Mount Etna means doing new plantation Alberello that cost more to be to work on it, but we like it. So we do new plantation using Alberello, say. So one woody stick each plant, and I'm really convinced that the when you plant, when you do spaliera, you have always a shade cone during the day. I don't know if I can explain very well, because one spaliera can cover the other one.
Yeah, they make dark to the other, they shadow the other vineyards.
When you do Alberello, the sun can turn
so around
the plants. So I think it's much better. Take more time, more money to cultivate them, it's much better. That's why we want to keep continuing on this way.
Good, Michele, good choice. Shall we go with the video, with the virtual tour of the winery for everybody's joy? Okay. So we start with Barricaia.
Yeah, this is our new Barricaia.
Can you see that, Michele? Can you see, guys?
Yeah. Under the soil. Our Barricaia is under the soil, and we have a Barricaia and Wine Lab right beside.
Okay, how many barrel do you have here, Michele, more or less?
Can you see the video? I cannot see the video. I mean,
you cannot see the video? Can you see? Okay.
It's not moving.
Can you see it right now?
No, not yet. Can you see, Benedetto?
Yes, I see everything. Can you see that, guys? Selwyn, can you see the video?
No. No, we can't see it, Benny.
Just a second. Let me see why. Maybe here.
We said that we see the picture.
Can you see here right now?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
So we are under the soil, new Barricaia, and our 700 liter barrels. And just behind in the next video.
How many barrique do you have, Michele?
How many?
Barrique.
At this moment, we have about 700 liter inside. And here is our wine library, where we collect year by year our vintages of Barbagalli, and our a tasting table inside the wine library. This is under the soil again.
Wow.
And this is our tinaia, where we do vinification, and the cement tulip, where we do fermentation of Barbagalli, Artineri Rosso, Rampante, and Santo Spirito, and in the stainless steel tanks, entry-level red wine.
Listen, Michele, sorry, a question on the cement tanks. So the cement tanks are, 100% cement, or inside there is a sort of glass that covers? So it's just cement?
If you put the glass, Benny, it's better to use stainless steel.
It's like stainless steel, right, yeah.
Cement inside, the cement outside.
Okay. Grazie, Michele. So here we are with the tasting room. Wow.
Room, our living room and our tasting table with the view on the vineyards.
Yeah, after the video, there is a picture of this room. That 360 degrees, that really gives you an open sight on this room. Wow.
And we have a terrace with the garden. Sorry, unfortunately the video is very quick, and the garden we have outside is a collection of local varieties of Mount Etna. We did a project with the Catania University for collecting a wild plants variety on Mount Etna, and we collected them in our garden. So we have a collection of local varieties in the garden. Yes.
I hope that there is a picture afterwards of that, Michele. Okay, so here we are with the vineyard. So it is these are the entry level, right?
This is the vineyards just outside the winery, which is there, and behind you see Mount Etna
here
in from the northern part. You see all the terraces, as you see, the idea of the winery, you will have better picture later on, the idea of the winery is to be a big terrace, like the terraces that we have with vineyards. The winery want to give the idea to be a big terrace in the vineyards. That's it. And our winery is built with 1 meter large volcanic stone walls.
Those here that we see on the left.
With the garden on the rooftop, it means that we use not too much electricity. We maintain a nice temperature inside thanks to this kind of eco-friendly construction.
Okay. Here we have Rampante.
Rampante Prephyloxera. You see the typical old terraces, Prephyloxera bushy shaped
bark. Over here.
And very, very, not uniform, very, very, let's say, unusual, because there is not a line, it's very unusual vineyards, as unusual are the Prephyloxera vineyards of Mount Etna. And in the past, the whole family, they used to put inside the vineyards a bit of everything, peach trees, apple trees, artichoke, everything to survive the family during the year.
Yes, yes. Forget the tidy vineyards of Piedmont. Here we are in Sicily, wilder.
The wild vineyards.
Where the wild things happen. Here we are again in Rampante.
Yeah, this is again the other part of Rampante. You see bushy shaped vines again. 100 years old vines.
What is this grass, Michele? Is that finocchietto?
There is a wild fennel. There are thousands of wild grasses. Some come May, June. It's unbelievable. You smell a lot of part. It's unbelievable. It's
Here we are in Arcinari. So those are the stones, right, Michele? Those are the stones that are used to make the terraces.
Typical volcanic stones of Mount Etna. All again, terraces, volcanic stones. This is a small terrace,
and the wishing well.
And the olive trees all around the vineyards.
And here we go with Barbagalli.
Here we are at about 950 meters above sea level in our hidden corner. This is a hidden corner for us. This is very silent. This is a relaxing place. This is a Barbagalli Vineyards, which is our grand cru. I like to call it our grand cru. And it's only 2,500 bottles per year, giving us an unbelievable product, giving us, thanks to the microclimate, thanks to the soil, thanks to a connection of many things all together, we have a Barbagalli.
Here it is not visible, Michele, but I remember the amphitheater shape
exactly.
Of the Barbagalli.
This is the typical shape of the vineyards, of the Prephyloxera vineyards on Mount Etna, yes.
Okay. And yes, let's see right now some pictures for... some more details. Tell me if you see everything at the minute or not. Can you see this picture?
Not yet,
okay. So just give me a second. Okay, yeah.
Barbagalli.
So here it's Barbagalli, yeah.
From another side, yes, from the top. We see from the top to the bottom. And you see behind.
Sorry. Okay.
Behind the olive trees, all lava. You have no more vineyards over there. You cannot grow. All lava, big lava flows.
Yeah. Wow.
And now.
Yeah, so it is the winery.
Back to the present, our winery with our volcanic stone walls and our winery from the front.
The little garden that you were saying with all the special plants of Sicily, is that in the left side or right side?
Up there, right and left. Up there, right and left, yes. That's all, it's a rooftop, under the rooftop we have the Tinaia, and then under the Tinaia Barricaia, and under the left side we have the storage area.
Okay. So here is the entrance.
Entrance.
Also, all these rocks and stones are all Etna stuff.
It's cut by hand and it's built by hand.
Wow.
Yeah, and all the winery is built with the volcanic stone, all the one. This is Mount Etna. This is Contrada Zottorinoto. This is a place where we produce, strange to say, a big part of our Etna Rosato. We decided to produce Etna Rosato using the 40 years old vineyards, because we give a great importance to our rosé, because rosé on Mount Etna is a serious wine. It's a wine that you can really use with a complete meal. It's not just an aperitive wine. So we decided when we start in 2010 to produce using a 40 years old. It's a vineyard that you can easily use for a grand crew, for a red wine. But we use this big part of this vineyard for producing rosé, because rosé is very important for us.
The structured rosé, definitely. So here is winter time.
Artinieri vineyards in winter time, yes, because we have snow. Don't forget that we have a couple of times per year we have snow, and we cannot even drive up there because we have 30-40 centimeters snow every year. So that's it. That's another side of Mount.
Did you have snow this past winter, Michele?
Sorry?
Did you have snow in this past winter?
Almost every year. Okay. Yeah.
And this here is the detail of the Barricaia. Here is the whole Barricaia, and here's some piece of art.
Exactly, we have some piece of art in our winery. We decided to go on this way to collect some important piece of art in our winery. In this picture, you have Alfio Bonanno, which is the one of the top artists for land art. What does it mean? It means that they use vegetal things, vegetal pieces like this one. This is a branch of acacia, and he produces a spiral with this acacia. So it's one of the biggest of the land art in the world. And we have a couple of pieces of art of Alfio Bonanno. And this is another important piece of art of Giorgio Vigna. This is a very important artist doing great things all around the world, the United States, in Far East. And he produced for us this piece of art, which is called the Pietre d'Acqua. It's 31 stones produced in Murano. On a water screen. So you have a nice sound when you are in the winery, and a nice feeling. And the name of this piece of art is Pietre d'Acqua, water stones.
Wow, very nice. Here is the cement tanks and stainless steel. Ah, this is nice. So this is the tasting room. Wow.
Yeah.
Never seen it, but beautiful.
Yeah. And this is a view of the Barricaia from the wine library. Yes.
Okay. Again. This is the tasting room. Yeah. And then yeah, I put together just the crew. I didn't put the DOC, the entry level one. I just wanted to focus on these big guys.
Yes. This is the all Prophylloxera. The volcanic lady means a Prophylloxera.
Yeah, that thing of the lady that means that it is all Prophylloxera is also easy to remember, so it's easy during for the sale.